Ladies and gentlemen, we are almost at the end of an exciting conference with so many events going on all around the world. And we will start this break with a recap of one of those events jointly organized by the Dutch embassies in Jakarta, Manila and Singapore.
For Malaysians, for Malaysian journalists, has been a very interesting year. We have, of course, had to face COVID-19. But we have also seen lots of political changes, political maneuvering. We've had one huge election that resulted in a worsening of the pandemic, but also we've seen really a new government, a new prime minister, and really just a new environment, a new political environment completely. So people say new normal. We've had many new normals here. So we, as journalists, we have had to really navigate that environment as well. The main risk or the main challenge that we have faced is how do we continuously get the information to our readers, you know, our citizens, you know, our fellow country people, but as well, but also keep ourselves safe and you know, minimize the risk of transmission. That has been really just constant risk assessment on our side. When do we actually go out? What can be done on the phone? What can be done on video? So this is constant risk assessment that we've had to do.
It's very difficult for us, especially in Davao City, because all we cannot, first we have to go through the health protocols, swab tests, then we have to ask permission from the police station so that we can cross the borders. And when we get to the border, they also have another kind of measures, so we have to comply with that. So it has become very difficult for us to move around as much as we would want to. And this is, of course, hampered how the way we get our stories. It has become very difficult for us to really verify the stories coming in, especially in social media, because we know there's a lot of misinformation going on in social media. So yeah, it's very difficult for us.
In Malaysia, I mean, I'm really glad that journalists are considered essential workers or frontline workers here. So even when we had the most severe lockdown, which we call movement control order in Malaysia, journalists were allowed to move around as long as you show your official pass and all that.
Some of my colleagues have suffered some sort of PTSD already, to be honest, exposure to this. And they need also to get professional counseling. And that's something that we have to change in the Philippines, in media landscape. These kinds of services are not being taken care of that much.
The press law itself has proven to be insufficient in providing necessary the legal cover for the press to operate safely in the digital space.
So as a managing editor, someone that is actually in high position, right? I feel bad that I could not do more for my journalists. But we realized if we decided to blow the case up, our journalists would face victim blaming from the society who have normalized sexual harassment as something small.
I have been arrested 7 times. I have been charged with 9 charges of sedition. I have been under travel ban, book ban, and my office has been raided several times. My webmaster also been arrested, and the printers factory who print my books also been raided. This is my philosophy. How can I be neutral? Even my pen has a stain. I believe that talent is not a gift, but talent is a responsibility. So whatever challenge we have to perform our responsibility as a cartoonist.
Actually, it's not really fair to let all these victims shoulder all this possibility of changing, you know, the historical change. This is a profound, we need a profound historical change. And unfortunately, it is on the shoulders of these victims.
Human rights matter. They matter whether we are in a pandemic or not. Human rights are not Dutch, not Western, but universal. Human rights are for everyone, regardless of who you are, where you're from, what you do, and what you believe in. journalism, yes, it's adventurous, too often dangerous, but above all, it is and will remain essential.
Well, who better to join us on International Human Rights Day? You already saw her in the video, our ambassador for the Netherlands, Mrs. Taib. Now, the autocue is messing my thoughts up, but welcome, Mrs. Taib Lee. We saw you there in the video. What were the highlights of this session for you?
Yes, thank you. So my name is Bahia Tahsib, a difficult name, I know, but it's a great pleasure and honor to be here today. And yesterday, I so much enjoyed taking part in the regional Jakarta event. Yeah. And actually, it was a very successful cooperation between three of our embassies, as you said, in Malaysia, Indonesia, and the Philippines. And I'm very proud of them. Yes, one of the highlights, we just saw Avi Mariani speaking about female journalists.
Very passionate.
Very passionate and so right in what she was saying.
Yes.
You know, yesterday, all the stories touched me very deeply because they really explained all the challenges that are out there for journalists while they're going about their work. And it's only increasing their challenges. But what really stuck with me yesterday is the plight of brave female journalists.
Yes, and we also already seen that in recent research shows that 20% of women journalists get attacked in real life from online bullying. So what's your view on that?
Yeah, so it's often starts online, and as you so rightly said, it then translates into offline, into real life, and that is extremely dangerous. And sometimes it's not only the woman itself, herself is not only targeted, but sometimes even their family members, their kids. So when you look, as you rightly said, at the facts and figures, you see 2/3 of female journalists around the world are threatened and harassed online, and they get horrible graphic imagery in their inboxes, on their social media accounts.
And that's more than men.
That's more than men. So yeah. They are not only attacked being a journalist, but they're also attacked being a woman. And it was a reminder for me how far removed we are still from gender equality, but also from an inclusive and diverse media landscape where journalists of all genders can do their work without fear and favor online and offline.
And now as a small kikker landje, we said, as a small frog's land, we say in Holland, what can we contribute to a solution of this problem?
Of this specific problem of female journalists, you mean? Yes, I think this conference is a very clear example. There was so much, first of all, attention to the challenges women, female journalists are facing. But I must say, I was also so proud that so many of the speakers and participants were brave female journalists and media workers. But at the same time, while we hear them speak powerfully and while they are a source of inspiration and resilience, we should not forget, as Avi Mariani said, the editor of the Jakarta Post, there's a hidden problem out there and we need to ensure a profound change in attitude.
Yes, yes, we do. What can we do in a more bigger story? What can we do as Netherlands to help combat human rights violations as a whole?
Yes, any country can do a lot. And I'm very proud that my country, the Netherlands, is doing a lot on this front. And I would like to share with you five very strong examples, successful initiatives. First of all, I think to start with this conference, we brought the whole world together at the World Press Freedom Conference. People spoke up and they really showed that they want to make a difference. So that's number one. Number two is, just 2 days ago, the EU foreign ministers came together and they adopted a global human rights sanction regime. And this was actually a Dutch initiative. So very soon we will be able to sanction human rights violators anywhere in the world. That is really a significant success. Then recently, I don't know if you remember that foreign minister, Mr. Stef Blok, he recently held Syria responsible for gross human rights violations, yes, including torture.
Yes.
That was a significant step towards justice. And you know, we became a member of the United Nations Human Rights Council. And one of the things the Netherlands did is we led a substantive resolution on freedom of expression and access to information. And it was a great success. It was adopted by consensus, so by everyone. And now we hear that journalists, human rights defenders, and others are using this resolution as a normative framework. And another example that I'm extremely proud of, we have 12 cities in the Netherlands who are offering temporary protection, like accommodation and security training to human rights defenders who are at risk in their home country. Like we all saw this amazing Syrian dancer at the opening of this conference, Ahmad Juneh.
Yes.
And he was one of this Shelter City program guests.
Yeah.
So this program was...
And he's getting his Dutch passport now.
Amazing.
So,
yeah, I mean, it's really wonderful. I mean, that brings such joy to our hearts, but it also gives us hope. It gives us hope that we should continue working towards promotion and protection of human rights for all anywhere in the world. But these cities, I think, really show that they can make a difference also at local level to people who are having a difficult time. And I'm so happy now this program is now going to be expanded so even more activists can benefit from this program. So taken together...
That's quite a lot for a small kicker lunch,
But when there is a will, there's a way. And doesn't matter whether you're a huge country or not, we can all help change the world and change it into a better place.
Yes. Well, thank you very much. And you've been at a lot of sessions, and we also saw you at the opening of the cartoon wall in
That's
The Hague
right.
here. Is there one thing in particular that you will take away from this entire conference these last 2 days?
Yes, the importance of freedom of expression, press freedom, and the safety of journalists. And what I really, you know, why is press freedom so important to me? Free press is so important, press freedom, to achieve any other human rights.
Yes.
To good governance, to democratic societies, but also to sustainable development. It is the foundation of a successful world where everyone can enjoy his or her human rights.
Thank you so much for that beautiful...
Thank you for having me.
Yes, thank you. Well, we're at the end and it's a wrap, ladies and gentlemen. So don't forget to sign up at our website for newsletters, overviews and highlights. And you can still watch all the sessions, including this one, up until the 31st of December on our UNESCO YouTube channel. Our cinema exhibitions and the library page will also remain open till the end of the year. So you can watch the newsroom content on newsroom.org, and don't forget to continue using the hashtag PressFreedom and EndImpunity to share all your stories. For now, stay tuned for the closing ceremony with Christian Anmapur, and thank you for watching. Stay safe.